Hi, everybody. Again, thank you for being here. What is ambitious storytelling? What are we talking about when we say that? I believe that the experience of storytelling can turn people who feel marginalized and silenced and turn them into powerful, connected, and empathetic participants and leaders. That is a place from which we start. This is why storytelling is inherently ambitious. When you keep in mind the framework of bringing people from one place into another, the act of storytelling is not ancillary to being a social entrepreneur. In fact, I find it central. So my ambition today is to be memorable. My ambition today is to tell a story that reaches you in a place that digs deep inside and maybe gives you an idea that you can turn into an action or a process back in your home countries, home offices, wherever you happen to work. My strategy for doing that is going to be to turn this presentation into a conversation. So I am not going to talk for an hour and you ask questions for 10 minutes. If I say something that sparks an idea or another story, please jump in. Please jump in. I will feel that this is an unsuccessful, unmemorable conversation if we don't have that. Last year during my talk at Skoll, there was a fire drill. I'm serious, we all had to leave. I'm up there, I had prepared for months, and I was like, shit. And everybody left and everybody came back, and it was the one talk that I knew they would not forget because it was interrupted by the fire drill. So I'm not sure I'm gonna have that covered because I've heard from the staff that they've turned off the fire alarms. So so this is good. We're not doing this alone. This is a talk that's gonna happen together. Oh, before I put my card down, I learned from the TED guy this morning that you're allowed to have one card, and I'm gonna use it for about the next 2 minutes. Because before we get started with the stories I'm about to tell you, I wanna just share certain assumptions from which I start this notion of ambitious storytelling. So well-told stories can bring people together. That's often a shared goal of storytelling. So well-told stories bring people together. Stories strengthen cultural identity. To me, the best stories strengthen cultural identity. I believe if you want to get people to act on the environment, you have to tap into a sense of pride in their heritage. I think that's what carries. So that's another assumption. Stories catalyze social movements. I believe it. I know it. And this talk will not set about proving that they do. It assumes that they do. Social storytelling, storytelling in general, deepens the impact of our work. It deepens the impact of our work because it connects us. I am here with some extraordinary storytellers. And I'm part of a group for whom storytelling is at the core of our being. When we meet social entrepreneurs, this artist group from Sundance, one might think we operate from very different places. I've noticed that social entrepreneurs, the social entrepreneurs in this community, are faced with a certain question of how do you all align your business goals and your social goals with creative innovation and the new needs of a connected, digital, virtual audience? These are questions that I know are being asked time and again. Artists and risk-taking storytellers all over the world are in process of trying to figure that out. Some go back to indigenous heritage, tribal roots, to try to find answers to that question. Others look to the future. Emerging technologies, virtual reality, augmented reality, you'll hear about some of those today, also to find that core, that meaning of aligning those needs to make that impact. And others are neither looking back or looking forward. They're actually being ambitious enough and fearless enough to look directly into the eyes of the people they serve and ask them for their stories. That is not easy. That takes capacity building. That takes an ability to be responsive. That takes making the time to listen. And so I say amen to all of you who are in the midst of trying to do that. In this room, there are some storytellers that I want to point out because they are here for the next few days and they inspire me every day. So In the back row there, we have Pete Nix, the director of the waiting room. You'll hear about his project later. Nicole Noonan is here with Jenny Nelson. They are the team behind the Revolutionary Optimist documentary and the new Map Your World project. We'll hear about those later as well. Sitting next to Nicole is Deborah Alden. Deborah is a communications designer, design researcher, strategist who has worked with Bunker Roy at Barefoot College and his team to help develop a tablet app to help the solar grandmothers, after they come to Barefoot College, learn solar engineering. But how do they stay connected with that information and with each other when they go back to their home countries? So they came to a lab that Sundance and Skoll sponsored to help figure that out. Deborah led that conversation. Kristen Feely and Rick Perez are Sundance staff who mentor and nurture filmmakers every single day of their lives, running labs, impact documentary, feature film, theater. Sundance does it all. Tabitha Jackson is the new head of the documentary film program at Sundance. These are all storytellers. Lynette Walworth, my dear friend from Australia, is an immersive, interactive installation artist. Now, you might think, how could you possibly marry social entrepreneurship with an immersive art installation? Lynette's work, please Google her, Lynette Walworth. There's an environment, if you can imagine creating a new space around a person to create that sense of awe that we talked about this morning, where you enter into an image and a story, and you can connect deeper into yourself. So it's not a moving image with an arc that leaves you, but you change as a person in the face of an immersive story. So you see Lynette's work in museums and planetariums and in unsuspecting places that disrupt the way you see the world. That is ambitious storytelling. That really makes change. And so my strategy for the rest of this hour is to give you some examples, as many as I can possibly fit into this time, of filmmakers especially, because that's who I work with at the core, but other artists as well, who are being ambitious with storytelling. And what I hope is that you'll take these ideas and rather say, oh, I could never do that because. I chose these examples because I thought and hoped that they would have relevance in your lives and that you will make the natural translation that you always do when you hear a great idea and think, how could I possibly do that? And how could I, and realize that you don't have to become the storytellers you see, although you are all storytellers, we all are, and every organization in this world at this moment in time is a storytelling organization, but the opportunities for partnerships with the artists you see here are real. The idea that you could have them in residence, the idea that you could work with them and partner with them to become better storytellers, these are all opportunities that Skoll supports, that Sundance supports, and that will deepen the impact that you're able to have in the world. So let's see if we can make this happen. And remember, I talk fast, I try to talk slower, but please interrupt me whenever is necessary, and let's have an iterative and collaborative conversation. So one quote I wanted to share with you, and it may be familiar, from the Skoll World Forum program book, I took one of the quotes, I think it was from Sally, and I changed one word, and I replaced storyteller. I replaced social entrepreneur with storyteller. So you get to defeat poverty, injustice, and environmental degradation. Storytellers don't impose their solutions. Instead, they work with those they serve, building the scaffolds to shared prosperity, self-determination, and sustainability. So not only social entrepreneurs do this, storytellers do this. There is a new breed of storyteller in the digital age that cares about making sure that their stories embed in communities so that not only so they can gather large audiences, which is of course important because we want that scale, but we want to move audiences to action. We care about the story beyond the screen when the lights come up. And that is not just a marketing process. That is not just a strategic engagement process. That is a storytelling process. That is a creative process. So the first project I want to tell you about is a film called Disruption. You have not seen it yet because it is just being finished as we speak. Disruption, what's really relevant about this film, it's about a band of activist economists in South America who are working in the poverty alleviation community. Yves Mori of Fundación Capital, who is a new Skoll awardee, is featured in the film. He's one of many characters. But the real characters in this film are the poor women who, through cash transfers, not only have they done what the cash transfers were intended to do, which is to feed their children, keep them in school, and keep them healthy, but they have taken those cash transfers and unexpectedly and without real training, opened businesses, formed lending circles, and run for office. This is the story of disruption. It's extraordinary. Tonight, if you're available to come to the screening at the theater, you will see the trailer to this film. But the ambition here, and this is the ambition of the filmmakers. So you get, sometimes it's confusing because you have an ambition of a social entrepreneur, an ambition of the poor women to better their own lives and be their own agents of change. But then you have filmmakers willing to say, my ambition is to tell a story that will influence global policymakers. That is one of the reasons. Yes, we want to create a great work of art that can that enables all people to have a transformative experience. But there are many filmmakers working now who want to work with you to make that happen, so that their outreach and engagement campaign is taking this film out of the theaters and showing it at the World Economic Forum, showing it at the United Nations, showing it for small audiences where they can turn one or two minds of government officials and bring more countries into believing that cash transfers are the way to do it. And financial literacy has to come along with those cash transfers. So I recommend the film. I recommend the global project of alleviating poverty. And I'm here to say the two are very, very deeply connected. More ambitious storytelling. The Waiting Room, for those of you in the healthcare fields, The Waiting Room is a film that has had a challenging road towards greatness. It is a film that Pete and I work, Pete is the director of The Waiting Room. It's about Highland Hospital in Oakland and the doctors working in the ER. What's ambitious about it is, well, there's many things that are ambitious about it. The film was, and I hope you don't mind me sharing this, but the film was rejected by 22 festivals. Before, it is hard to be a filmmaker, people. You have to really, really want it. You have to get steeled to rejection. Until when it hit its stride, award, 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 award. And then here's a film about a waiting room, about really focusing on these doctors and the doctors serving the poor and the poor in the waiting rooms. And here's a film that now got, and Pete got invited last year to speak at the Mayo Transform Conference. So he took a film about a single inner city hospital in Oakland and brought it to the global stage. What is also ambitious about it is that in the process of the filming, right at the beginning, as he was just getting into this film, he's like, how do we capture the voices of the people in the waiting room? How do we turn, and we were answering a question, how do we turn the waiting room into an expression room? And Pete was committed to that process. So he put filmmakers in the waiting room to capture their stories. And while he was making a feature film, a huge undertaking, he also created a web project that launched way before the film, where people, the audience could start engaging. The audience was actually starting to turn into a community in the process of the telling. That is ambitious storytelling. It's like it's not a one-on-one conversation. It's a two-way conversation. And Pete had the commitment from the very beginning to ensure that that happened. It takes, not every filmmaker can do that. Not every filmmaker wants to do it. Some, and it's not a better or worse, but when you are committed to it, that's a piece of that ambition. And the film has been out. The website is up. You can experience those stories. But the ambition doesn't end, and the project is still happening. I recently got a grant to do an interactive photography project that's going to be large 5-foot fences in Oakland that when you hold your phone up to the fence, you can get stories and data and buy the photograph, and it creates a creative economy for Oakland. It's going to be installed at Jack London Square for a year next year, and it's going to include 25 NGOs in Oakland being able to meet at the fence, experience performances at the fence, and interact with images that come out of community. So who did I go to first to try to help really demonstrate what the fence was going to be about? I went to Pete, because he had collected extraordinary stories, and we can demonstrate this technology using stories that have already existed. And today, at the Skoll World Forum, Pete was able to connect with health leads to talk about an idea he has for a bus that will be a traveling story bus in front of hospitals that have inside the bus storytellers and healthcare workers and foundation people from healthcare foundations. It's going to be incredible. This is the ambition. This is the ambition of seeing stories live in the world and be part of those conversations that are transforming global culture. And it starts locally, it starts small, it starts one-on-one, and I really, really hope you check out the waiting room online. And if you can get involved, if you can see a platform where you are, try it. The next story is so, I live with this project for many, many years and have been involved with it on a number of levels. This is the poster for a film that came out a number of years ago by my friend Banker White and Zach Niles called The Sierra Leone Refugee All-Stars. It's about a band that started in the Sierra Leone refugee camps. Extraordinary film, again, many awards, awesome group of musicians. When those filmmakers left Sierra Leone, they were plagued with a question that really plagues a lot of documentary filmmakers, that it really informs the basis of documentary ethics. How do we leave the communities where we work better than when we got there? You go into communities, the idea is capturing stories, taking stories out. What if you actually put your mind to thinking how you could put stories back in? How can you embolden the communities whose stories you take and put on film? So these guys were inspired to go back and do storytelling workshops for the young people in the refugee camps. So they did that. They went back. They did a storytelling workshop that really was quite successful. They went back and they did another storytelling workshop. And they're like, Wendy, it's really hard. They came to me. I was running an organization in San Francisco called the Bay Area Video Coalition. And we were fiscal sponsors of many projects around the world. And they're like, we need to build them an online media channel. Because there was very, very slow internet. They couldn't get the stories out of Sierra Leone. We couldn't share this extraordinary storytelling that was taking place. And so I said, OK, let's do that. So gave them a grant. We crowd fundraised, and we built this online media channel that all of a sudden was, if you go to, it's live at WeOwnTV.org, and you can see some of the stories that these young people started capturing and telling and sharing. But it didn't stop there. The ambition continued, because they saw this creative economy start to bubble up. They're like, they need a bricks and mortar media center. So they built them one that is now fully staffed by the young people, the sons and daughters of the Sierra Leone Refugee All-Stars and their community. And what's happened now with the WeOwnTV Media Center is that they are being hired by brands doing business in Africa who want authentic storytelling. When there are visiting dignitaries to Sierra Leone, they hire WeOwnTV. It just, I mean, it's the reason I freaking get up in the morning, is to see stories come to life in such a way. And what's interesting, one bit of information that I wanted to point out that came up a little bit during our talks this morning at the convening, is that the participants in this workshop were not chosen because they had film experience. They were not chosen because they had any expertise in any digital media. They were chosen by enthusiasm, eloquence, and sense of purpose. Because that's what is sustainable. That comes from within them, and you have these new leaders who are now training each other. It's real peer-to-peer, and the next generation is going to get ready to come up after this. Jeffrey Black Nature is a was the youngest Sierra Leone refugee all-star. He witnessed his parents being murdered in front of his eyes. He became very close with Banker White, one of the core filmmakers. Banker brought him to the United States to do a training before they got the training programs together in Sierra Leone. Banker brought Jeffrey to BAYVAC, and he got the training he needed at one of our training programs. And when we interviewed him about how it went, the experience of sharing my story has totally changed my life. That you can get grants and you can get support and you can get mentorship, but there is something about exchanging that narrative that really was the engine behind all of this. So it's he found a girl in Richmond, California to marry. So he is now a true citizen of the world. And we're super proud of what he's doing. He has a musical career, a media career, and he is one of many in Sierra Leone. And this is a model that Banker's actually interested in replicating. So if any of you are thinking of ideas, could you do this on the ground somewhere else? Is it happening on the ground somewhere else? Let's make more models like this, where stories are actually inflecting community and economic development. Oh, this is one last quote from the Skoll World Forum book, where I substituted storytellers for social entrepreneurs. You may think ambition is invisible, but its energy is undeniable, offering a vast, infinitely renewable resource that storytellers use to tap to bring their visions to life. So storytellers, it's not just a creative, siloed experience. And I think it mirrors a lot of the work and the thought process of social entrepreneurship. This is Nicole's film, a still from Nicole's film, The Revolutionary Optimists. This is Salim. Salim is a young man in a slum outside of Calcutta who is part of a group of young people mentored by a visionary social entrepreneur named Amlan Ganguly, who runs an organization called Priyasam. And Nicole and Jenny and her producing partner, Maren Granger Monson, who is a physician at Stanford, they were shooting the story of Amlan and these young people. Amlan's job was turning young kids into change makers in their community. So this is Salim taking a baby to be immunized against polio during one of their drives. How did the ambition come about in this story? Nicole came to a lab that I run, funded by the MacArthur Foundation, called the Producers Institute for New Media Technologies. While they were filming these kids going door to door with yellow legal pads, counting the number of babies being born without, who were not being immunized, this notion of what could they do as filmmakers, as storytellers, to embolden this community, to empower them. And we came together and we brought Matt Berg, an incredibly renowned data scientist, technologist, who ran a company called Child Count. He runs a company now called Ona Data, an open data platform. He was affiliated with Columbia. He came, Google came to the table and said, let's give them a mobile app. Let's give them an app so they don't have to, Amlan doesn't have to punch in the handwritten data into the computer and then we get health workers to come out to immunize these kids. Let's have the data go directly to where it needs to go and let's lower the polio rates. And they did that. Nicole, was it like 70% of, what's the right piece of data there?
It was from 60 to 40 to 80 originally.
Yeah, so 80% of the kids were now, only 40% had been immunized, now 80% were. And they did this. They went around the neighborhood with megaphones. Actually, let me show you. Let me show you what they did.
আমাদের সবচেয়ে বড় সমস্যা হলো পানীয় জল।
Do you have a transit pass issued by the school?
No, I walk to school.
Have you been a victim of violent crime?
It's not good for the environment.
Yeah, birds can like eat anything.
Animals can die because of them.
ম্যাপিয়ার ওয়ার্ল্ড প্রজেক্টটা পুরো মানে ওয়ার্ল্ডেই চলছে
তো আমার আমি জলের সার্ভে করব কোনটাতে হলুদ জল পড়ে বা কোনটাতে লাল জল পড়লে আর এটা আমি মোবাইলে করছি কারণ এইটা মোবাইলে করলে আমার ডাইরেক্ট ইন্টারনেটে চলে যাবে হলুদ জল পড়ে বিশাল হলুদ বাবা
Our children's goal is to convince the community representatives that look we are fighting a cause So please take this map to the concerned authority and bring water for us.
So these red dots are the different places where we collected data, and they show up on the map.
Eventually, we started making graphs of all our data. And I think the most we ever found was at 843 at the fountain.
We want to get a picture of where incidents of violence happen and where students have been targeted.
With the data, we're trying to find out how far students live away from the school and if they've been a victim of crime getting to school.
Probably people doubt us because we're children, but when we have all of that evidence of what is actually happening, it's probably going to help a lot. The revolutionary optimists, Salim Shika and the whole team in India, they've really inspired us.
We really saw kids developing their identity when we were out there gathering signatures for the petition.
The Map Your World project allows you to take the project where the kids are going, so you provide them some guidance, and then follow them and see where they take it.
What are your guys' favorite subjects?
My favorite subject is history.
Can you sing a song for us?
আমরা কিছুদিন আগে স্কাইপে কথা বলেছিলাম ম্যাপিয়ার ওয়ার্ল্ড সম্পর্কে তার মানে যারা করছে আমাদের মতো তো এটা একটা নিজের মধ্যে কি হয় যখন লোককে আমি কাজ করতে দেখি নিজের মধ্যে একটা মানে সাহস থাকে বা একটা বিশ্বাস থাকে না আমিও পারবো
Just to go back for one second, Map Your World is launching this week, and we, Nicole and Jenny, have brought beautiful tablet computers that we have been giving to many of the Skoll social entrepreneurs to be able to pilot Map Your World projects in their community. They're here. Please talk to them after today. If you have a second generation program within your organization, if you're looking for ways to bring youth into the change making, this is a way that they can also hone their storytelling skills, their data collection skills, their networking skills, and we'd like to help you. Google has donated many tablets to us that we are re-granting to organizations that are interested in pursuing this work with us and building the network. So all of these stories that you saw were part of the alpha testing phase of this project, and we really look forward to working with you. So hopefully that can be a trajectory. You guys are not helping me with my goal of being interactive. Any questions before I move on? Yeah, please. One sec.
Thank you. Thank you for this beautiful presentation. Just want to bring the scale back to the very human being. Storyteller does transform the life of the storyteller. Storytelling is amazing. I mean, my experience as a mother, I never knew this could do that. I was doing it for the kid. Mm-hmm. But then the kid in me was there awakened. I did not know that. Mm-hmm. So throughout years and years of exquisite fairy tales, it's a great thing to be a mom in the US because you can find fantastic books with the mediocre ones too, but from Tibet, from India, from Japan, from Africa, from South America, from the Appalachian Mountains, yeah. Fairy tales became my life for over 15 years. Mm. I'm a transformed person. So let's never forget that power of the telling a story. Now, of course, I tell stories all the time about how we came into this world. Every child loves it. It's my field is prenatal mm-hmm. psychology.
Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
We are bound to telling a story. Thank you.
I agree. Thank you. I like to, a phrase I use maybe too much, is going, finding your once upon a time. Yes. And it's very transfer. I agree. Thank
and
you.
We have many of those.
Yes. Thank you. Was there something else? Anyone? Okay. A few more stories. Then maybe you'll get more talkative. Okay. Let's move on to When I Walk, something very different. When I Walk is a film by my friend Jason De Silva. He had a big ambition. He was setting out to make a film. He had made a few films. And then he was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis. And he just kept filming.
As a kid, I discovered filmmaking. This was me 5 years ago, making documentary films and traveling the world. And then I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis.
When you feel down, think of other countries, other people.
I get a film grant and take off for India. Maybe I can find something here to make me better. But I'm getting worse so fast, I feel like my time is running out.
I had no idea that this would happen so fast.
Quit your film right now. How does it feel? Just quit.
I'm not gonna quit the film.
To help me gain perspective, my mom takes me to an MS support group. There was this girl there. Her name is Alice, and I got her phone number. I decide to give Alice a call. I may be walking slower, but inside, I'm racing.
That was really, really fun.
I sent an email to my dad, and I said, can you date someone with MS? And my dad said, yes, I'm dating someone with MS right now.
Do you ever wish that you're with somebody able-bodied?
Yeah. But I wish you were able-bodied.
He's like this incredible person.
Lady didn't cure him. Instead, she gave him another miracle.
Well, what's that?
Alice.
How is it that you're so magical? It's hard to know where our stories are going as they're being written. That's the mystery of fate.
Happy to report that Jason and Alice had a baby last year. But Jason's ambition didn't end there. If you can imagine, just finishing that film, considering what was going on with him physically, was challenging enough. And having his story inspire his new community, ambitious enough. But he needed to do more. He wanted to do more. So he came to the same institute where we developed Pete's project and said, what can I do to help other folks in wheelchairs navigate their world? Because his world kind of in New York, it kind of shut down when he started being in a wheelchair. And he noticed that businesses that said they were accessible when they had one step, when you're in a big, heavy, motorized wheelchair, one step is it. You're done. And so he came to the Producers Institute in a story-driven environment. We brought Google technologists to the table, augmented reality developers to the table, and he set about becoming a social entrepreneur, building practically what is now a startup tech company, where it started out as a browser extension to Yelp so that people could do reviews of businesses through the lens of accessibility, that folks in wheelchairs could take videos, post them, share them, map all of the accessible businesses, and in a real way, rate them. And then he added, and he wants to go global with this, so multiple cities of really creating an accessible space for people in wheelchairs and canes, because we're all getting less and less able, right? And so, but he didn't stop with just the map and basic accessibility. We added an augmented reality layer so that if you're in a wheelchair in New York City and you're out in the street and you want to know where you could go, you can now hold your phone up to your location and get feedback and data of accessible businesses where you are, where you can meet for coffee, go to the movies, find a library book, whatever it might be. And this is really taking off. Google is fantastically interested in this. And that's what's going to help him scale. You know, a lot of these scaling of story ideas, just as with your own ideas in your own organizations, they take partnerships to scale. And these partnerships are sometimes difficult to navigate. They take some ambition to be able to make sure the story can be preserved and the goals can be met. But with that together, it's like these things work because they're data and stories together. It's not just a data tool, okay, here's where it is, but at the same time you're receiving the data, you can hear a story. You open up your heart, you get evidence, and things, the world changes. So I'm moved every day by what Jason's been about and what he's still doing. He is committed to this, and it's now, he's not making his next film yet. His project is Access Map and Access Labs and creating a better world for people with disabilities.
So I have a question for you. What does it mean to you to be a black male?
What is your purpose in life?
How do we reclaim our communities?
At what point do young people stop respecting the elders?
What are you doing to make your world and your community a better place?
How
do we break the cycle?
Why?
Why do so many of us live in the present tense?
What is the last word that we can remember you by?
Question Bridge is a video-mediated megalogue between African-American men, where we use video as a format to facilitate a conversation between people who are separated by class, age, geographical, philosophical, and cultural differences. The process is deceptively simple. An African-American man looks into the camera, similar to the way I'm looking at you. They then pose a question to someone they feel different or estranged from. We then show that question to someone we feel can answer that question. We as artists never asked or answered any of the questions. We are just the facilitators.
I got a question.
Who are you?
What is your purpose in life?
What do you live for?
What makes you black?
And why are y'all doing this video?
Over the course of several years, we traveled the country and received over 1,600 questions and answers from over 160 African-American men.
So here's one black man. Who started this? What is that? Why do black men do that? And I noticed we only kind of do that in America when I'm up in Canada working. I don't really see too many Canadian black men doing. What's that about?
My question to the black man in America or anywhere else is, what is common to all of us that we can say makes us who we are?
What are you scared of? What do you fear?
What am I scared of?
So far, we have successfully launched several of the project's platforms. That's the art installations all over the nation. Community dialogues and education curriculum initiatives have impacted over 100,000 perspectives on the black male in America. Now, we are embarking on a national mission with you that incorporates a creative, interactive campaign so that we can impact millions of Americans.
That is some hella ambitious storytelling, as we say in Oakland. Now, think about it. Question bridge, black males. As we were developing this idea of question bridge, I was like, wait, I want to question bridge Jewish women right now. It's like this is a storytelling model that if you have ambition around storytelling, they are making this available. You don't have to create technology from the ground up. That's the beauty of open source. You can work with an extraordinary team who wants to see more question bridges in the world. Question Bridge had a preview at the Sundance New Frontiers and then had a mutual opening at the Oakland Museum and the Brooklyn Museum in the United States. To this day, it is the most highly trafficked exhibit that the Brooklyn Museum has ever had. I grew up at that museum taking ceramics classes, and there was hardly ever anyone in there. They had a resurgence of energy and passion and engagement at this museum when Question Bridge came in. It's been at science museums, and to think that it's not just, and it's not a feature film, this is a storytelling project that hits people where they live, that confronts racial bias, that even from anyone to be able to admit, I'm going to sit in a room for 45 minutes and listen to stories from people who, if they were walking towards me on the street, I might cross the street. And then in order to deal with those feelings, they have roundtables at every institution where the installation happens to work on internalized racial bias from within the community, external discrimination, and have it deeply embedded in curriculum modules so that we can unlearn that bias from very young. And you can have more images like this of fathers and daughters amidst all the data of black men incarcerated and the number of the percentages of daughters that are actually raised by their fathers. All of that crisis data through this kind of storytelling can turn into data of resilience. And that's what we must do. That's what we're about. So if anyone is interested in a question bridge with their group, you come talk to me. I am associated with them and I will connect you immediately. We want to see more of these. Okay, let's get a little less cultural and a little more technological. This is now an old project that was completely groundbreaking when we started it. This is a still from virtual Guantanamo. And instead of yakking to you about it, watch this.
What happens behind these barbed wires? The little information that comes out of Guantanamo Bay through former prisoners, their lawyers, or the occasional NGO is remarkably consistent. They all report similar horrors. Beatings, electric shock, people chained to walls, floors, their heads plunged into ice-cold water.
Dogs barking at naked prisoners while loud music is being fired into their ears. People are being taunted with pictures of their children, saying that you're never going to see them again. The screams of women are being used to break detainees' wills.
The man speaking here is British national Muazzam Beg. He spent almost 3 years in the infamous prison before he was released in 2005. In her 2004 documentary Unconstitutional, writer-director Noni de la Peña used footage of Muazzam's father reading his son's letters from Guantanamo.
I've been kept like an animal in a cage. They don't give me food. There is no one to help me.
Under the second life name Noni Ryder, De La Peña is behind the Gone Gitmo project, situated on a rooftop on IML Island. The sim is run by the Interactive Media Division at USC School of Cinematic Arts. Noni is convinced that the issues surrounding Guantanamo can be brought much closer to home via Second Life.
There's a sense of the reality to it. So when your avatar goes into a cage, it's a very visceral feeling, beyond watching it in a film, beyond reading about it in the paper. Geography doesn't matter.
With a grant from the Bay Area Video Coalition, Noni and USC visiting Professor Peggy Weil used famous builder Babacar Fairchild to create interactive Guantanamo.
Guantanamo is physically off limits to most citizens and press. keep a topic out of sight and it stays out of mind. So in the face of a real but inaccessible destination, we felt that Second Life offered us a chance to build an accessible, albeit virtual, version.
De La Peña and Weil also realized they would have to deal carefully with the implications of depicting questionable interrogation practices.
We do not torture your avatar. So rather than a torture chamber, we elected to build a contemplation chamber, a series of spaces to contemplate the reports of practices going on in Guantanamo, as well as the current news via RSS feed.
As soon as I had put on my orange jumpsuit, I was thrown into the back of a C-17 transport plane and...
You are immediately bound, and then a black hood comes over the vision of your avatar.
Shut up!
We then integrated some sounds that were based on descriptions of what real detainees heard. When the black hood is removed, you find that you're in a cage. Most of the footage is from original Defense Department shots of detainees at Guantanamo Bay.
A replica of Camp Delta will be added to this camp X-ray soon. Noni wants it to include a habeas corpus game, enhancing the simulation of a place outside of the law.
Like a regular video game where you get your choices. What do you do now? Call your parents? Call your lawyer? Ask what you're in here for? And the answers are, no, you can't call your parents. No, you can't call your lawyer. Sorry, not allowed to give you that information.
Noni de la Peña hopes her SL project reaches a responsive audience. On Constitution Day, residents used the bill to interact with faculty from Seton Hall Law School, which has been on the forefront of analyzing detainee records. Like other strategies of wartime's past, the idea behind Guantanamo is the dehumanization of the enemy, says Noni de la Peña. Second Life should be used for the opposite, meeting the perceived enemy face-to-face, breaking down barriers, both geographical and in our heads.
The Palestinian-Israeli border, a couple of gang neighborhoods, and then bring the gang members into Second Life to take each other through their neighborhoods. Given what we know about how much people identify with their avatar, what kind of experience would that be for people?
Fascinating indeed. I'm Dragster Dupre, reporting for Life for You News, contemplating the future of humanity in a tiny cell wearing orange.
Ambitious. Noni de la Peña began this project when she had absolutely no technological experience. She was a science writer for the New York Times, but had some ambition around changing the world through media. And so she went from this Second Life project, which is now pretty historical, went to USC as one of the first graduate students in immersive journalism. What Noni did the end of last year was she created an experience of virtual Syria with these now 3D goggles that you put on. She did a 3D project at Sundance that was also as part of her USC fellowship called Hunger in America, where people walked, imagine this, you walk into a museum, some exhibit space, and you're given glasses and a path to walk on. And all of a sudden, you watch people doing this. It's an examination of hunger in America. So they are walking, what it looks like they're walking in this room, but on their faces, they have an immersive experience of being on a food line in front of a shelter. And you are inhabiting this story. You're walking along, and all of a sudden, you see people who are walking with these glasses crouching on the ground, helping people up, crying, because they are completely immersed in the story that's being told in front of their eyes. And they're helping people that are like using their real bodies, so they're immersing in an idea and a story and environment, creating a sense of empathy that is really unlike any that has been created before. So Noni took that same technology and created an experience for folks who were in Davos for the World Economic Forum. And it was really a transformative experience for them. And it's going to be really interesting to watch this kind of technology develop. Second Life, where she built virtual Guantanamo, is now kind of a testing ground for Oculus Rift and the new 3D technologies that will become much, much more ubiquitous than they are now for both storytelling and world-changing, transformative events. So just wanted you to know about it. It's way above the capacity of most of us to really get into, but in terms of if you have research relationships with universities working in this space, we want technologies like this to be used for humanitarian purposes from the beginning. You know, it's always the NGOs that are kind of last to the table with new and innovative technologies that you find the business case first, you find the commercial cases first, and it's like we're last to the table, oh, let's do something good with it. It's like, no, no, no. We want artists and humanitarians at the tables with the developers, and we're starting to build more and more circles that can do that so the narrative of the human race can be part of the development of this technology. I love Fanny Armstrong. She's from here and from London, and she is a filmmaker who made a really wild environmental film and a number of years ago called The Age of Stupid. And I really just wanted to share this quote. Perhaps if the impact of cinema is hard to quantify, it's not an indication of its failure to change the world, which is often a criticism, but of the occasionally insidious way in which it does so, not by changing the world exactly, but by subtly changing the minds of the people in it. What influence could 250 million angry, inspired, motivated citizens possibly have? Now, that impulse of this notion, there's two notions to pick up here. One is, how do you know when someone's mind has been changed? There's a lot of people now around the world trying to figure out how you track that kind of impact data, because some things cannot be measured. Like we mentioned this morning, character, sense of purpose. There's things that are very cellularly important cannot be measured. But storytelling is a way of anecdotally collecting cultural, social data. And the stories that you create, the stories that are told by your people on the ground, become your cultural data. And we need to find a way to give that back into the databanks in some way. Because we know the influence that 250 million angry people can have. And that influence must be counted and must be considered. One last video I want to show you of a story about rape in the military in the US. The reason I bring it here will be pretty apparent. But I want to push home one last point as we're wrapping up towards the end of this presentation. Is that how you, if you consider storytelling at the beginning of an initiative that you're doing, at the beginning of a campaign, at the beginning of any kind of new engagement with a community, you recognize a need, and if you put storytelling, effective, powerful storytelling around it, the kind of impact it can have in moving the needle, in changing policy, in sometimes it's unreachable. Sometimes the long tail of deep social impact is too long to stay with it. Most of the people in this space know what it takes and do stay with it. But filmmakers, artists in general, we're used to going from story and really wanting to tell the next story. But sometimes moving on to the next story too soon begins to feel a little unethical when people's lives are in the balance. Take a look at that.
Read my lips. The military must end rape.
There's a new documentary, a very important one, and it proves that the ugliest battles sometimes can take place far from the front lines.
Everything changed the day that I was raped.
He hit me in the head and knocked me out.
I remember holding the closet thinking, what just happened?
A month later, I found out I was pregnant.
In The Invisible War, director Kirby Dick, along with filmmaker Amy Ziering, set out to expose the epidemic of rape in the United States military and document the failure of each branch to protect its own servicemen and women from sexual violence.
This rape crisis in the American military has come to light thanks to the Academy Award-nominated documentary, The Invisible War.
There's an embedded serial predator problem, and these crimes are not being prosecuted. And no one is doing anything about it. And this has been going on for decades, and it's time for a change.
The decision to investigate and prosecute these crimes is made within the chain of command. That has to be taken out of the chain of command.
What's going on is you have an extremely small percentage of people exploiting a system that's flawed.
And this is what we're asking the Secretary of Defense and the Pentagon to do, is to go after these people and investigate, prosecute, and incarcerate them. Put them away. Go after them with the same will that they fight a war.
Using Department of Defense statistics with rape survivors and their families, the film exposes not only the rampant sexual assault found in our military, but also the systematic cover-up and punishment of the few survivors that report it.
I reported it two different times to my squad leader, and he told me that there is nothing he can do about it because I didn't have any proof.
If a man gets accused of rape, it's a setup. The woman's lying.
They did charge me with adultery. I wasn't married, he was.
The audience award goes to the Invisible War.
And the Spirit Award goes to the Invisible War.
In the few months since the film's release, the Invisible War has done what advocates and politicians have been trying to do for decades: change United States military policy. 48 hours after seeing the film, former Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta transferred the decision to prosecute out of unit commander's hands and up to the rank of colonel.
We've been very heartened. It's been incredible. The response from the military has been extremely, extremely positive. In fact, Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta saw the film and 2 days later held a press conference to announce significant policy changes, which he himself said was a direct result of the impact the film had on him.
While the goal is to take the decision out of the military entirely, the move is a step in the right direction, and only the first step of many for which this film is responsible. In fact, since the film's release last year, it has inspired the proposal of 16 new pieces of legislation, several of which have successfully been voted into law. Additionally, it is estimated that over 250,000 of our service members have watched the film, and it is now being used as a training tool on military bases throughout our nation.
Most people in the military are horrified by this, and when we have shown the film, we've gotten remarkable response. They're hearing the film as a critique, not an attack.
The movie is so powerful and is such a game changer because it is able to lay out that it's not an isolated thing, it's a real epidemic that has not been tackled and has not been fixed.
So what is, in my mind, what's interesting here, that tremendous impact, that film did not have an interactive installation. It did not have an app. It didn't have other kinds of new technologies with it. It had an extraordinarily powerful story with really great partners like Sundance, mentors, and it had an issue whose time had come. And so sometimes, you know, and a short video can do this too. We have a short video that goes viral around the web and 12 million views. What does 12 million views mean? Part of, I will be remiss if I don't leave you with this notion of keep with your story and tell the story of that story. If you get a grant from a great foundation to help make change happen, give them a story back. And in that narrative, we'll show the power to enter culture, the power to make those changes. Narrative can capture that better than data points, better than almost anything. So you want to, you know, these tools that professional artists bring to the table, the notion of how you might be able to channel them in the work that you do and find those voices with the folks that you work with who are being transformed every day by your commitment to them, I think is really, really powerful. Now, I'm not letting you leave this room until you give me some stories back. So can we hear a little bit just from each other of maybe how you're currently using stories? What are the most powerful ones that you can maybe share with us?
Hi, my name's Marcia. I wanted to ask a question primarily.
Please.
I had the good fortune to work with Amy Ziering and Kirby on their next movie. Their next documentary is about college sexual assault. And as she was speaking, it became very evident that she's busy building the social movement that will go on campus as she was building the film. So the question I have for Sundance or for Pete is this going to transform the role of a director or producer? Do you now have an obligation to build a social movement, or can you make a documentary for the other reasons, which was to inform or inspire?
You know, you just nailed a core place of tension in our field right now. I know you do, and you just have to wait 1 second. I know you do. I'm going to give you the mic in 1 second. I just wanted to frame it with the context that Sundance just came from a week of deep impact talks in New York with the likes of Rockefeller Foundation, Ford Foundation, Fledgling Fund, all and producers and strategists to figure out how do we support filmmakers in this new space, but also to consider that not every filmmaker is made and it's not in their DNA to do this. And sometimes a film should just be a film. And often, I know Pete has a lot to say about it, and I want to let him speak. It raises an opportunity for change makers, non-artist change makers potentially, because that is a space that for me, the storytelling, when the film is out, that's a new beginning, and that some of us are engaged in the social movement after, consider themselves activist filmmakers. But for those who don't, it doesn't mean they don't want their film to have impact. So you want to work with filmmakers? Step up. Do you know what I mean? There are so many that would love to build a platform, tell a story, hand the film over, and know that you will shepherd it, you know, into the world and have that deep meaning. Pete, talk from your experience. Tell what you really think about this, please.
I do feel like in a lot of ways, I've become a social entrepreneur. Not necessarily by choice, but because there is such a, like you said, a feeling of responsibility when you step into an environment of story, like you do in a hospital waiting room. You see so much need. There is this recognition that you need to do more, you know, than just make a film. Mm-hmm. And I think. The message that some of us are designed, we are sort of naturally able to do that, and I think I'm crazy enough to be able to take on more than I really should, and because a lot of this, you know, building a movement is just as much work as building a film. And I think with Kirby and Amy, I think Amy's they have a very nice partnership where he kind of focuses on the filmmaking maybe, and then Amy sort of focuses on building the movement around it. And I think for any, this isn't a conference for filmmakers necessarily, but I always tell filmmakers, you know, partner with people who can help you build that movement and really focus on your story. And I think it's also relevant for the NGOs to think of when you're trying to tell your story, not to think so much about the impact, but to zoom in and think about the story. Because if you do tell a story well and it's powerful and it's emotional, people connect to it emotionally, mm-hmm. movements will build around that.
Yeah.
And I think if you think too much about impact from the outset, then you sort of miss
that.
You will miss the story, and then the story that you do tell might come off as feeling manipulative
or
more propaganda.
Thank
so
you.
Those are my thoughts on it.
Thank you. Artists love complication and nuance. Activists don't love that so much. But there is a way, I believe, that we can really work together. Down here, and then after, yeah. No, let's go 1, 2, yeah. Oh, fine.
I'm also kind of a filmmaker, I guess I am. I'm making my first documentary film. I just finished actually my PhD here at Oxford.
Oh, wow.
And so I started out as an environmental scientist working in Cambodia with a community who are doing activism in a forest called Prey Long. And while making the film, I got to know quite well the leader of that movement, a man called Chut Vati. And the first I met him, he was actually attacked. And 6 months later, after I had filmed several interviews with him and with the communities there, I got the news while I was here in Oxford that he had been killed. Mm. And that was really devastating, and it changed everything that I was doing, and I went back to film more. But what I wanted to share just now is that for me, the storytelling and the reality are completely intermeshed. And I've had dreams where Ruti was alive and I was in a play and I was directing the play, and at the same time I was in the play. And when I woke up, I was sort of like, well, that is how it is, really. Mm. The story is the reality. And
thank you.
And they sort of, and also the story changes the world. So it goes both ways.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to bring out another aspect of storytelling, because I'm not a filmmaker like Pete. Mm-hmm. But what I have done is to represent people in rural Uganda. I work in a very small villages in Uganda, in rural Uganda, where we have... I started working with children, taking them to school because they are orphaned because of HIV/AIDS. But because the community is still able to sustain itself through women, which is why I like Barefoot College in India, we were able to bring 7,000 grandmothers to who are raising 43,000 children and empower these women to realize the potential they have. Mm. Not only to sit back in a rural village and wait for charity for somebody to give them money, but to get economically empowered and send their own children on their own every morning, paying for them to go to school. But what that story has done, it has transformed these women from viewing themselves as in a paternalistic society where a woman just sits back, waits for a husband, husband brings money, if you make money, you give it to your husband. Now to earning money with or without a husband, they are able to keep their own money. The story hasn't been told, and I would like to know how to get my hands on that tablet.
Okay, we want you to have tablets. You talk to these ladies up there.
To get the story now beyond just the book I published with Penguin, I have told the story one by one, viral, talk to my friend talks to another one, mm-hmm. but I've always wondered how you get to put that YouTube clip that will bring 250,000 people. So I think you're an answer to our question. Yeah. But the stories of these women, it's not only empowering people around the world, it has empowered them, and now they see themselves in a different view completely from how they viewed themselves, just as caretakers,
yes.
beggars, wait for somebody to help you, to now I can change my life, mm-hmm. no matter who helps me or who comes to my story.
Thank you for that. That's incredible. Up there? Is there a mic up there? Gabrielle, thanks.
Thank you very much for the excellent presentation. I work at Girls Not Brides, so we're a partnership of NGOs, and I think a lot of our members really see the value in storytelling. But storytelling done well takes time and investment, both in terms of money and time and understanding. And, you know, I would welcome your thoughts on how, you know, as NGOs, what is needed from us, from a filmmaker, at the same time in a way that we can manage. Mm. It takes a lot, and I think there's more of an open, frank conversation that we can have between filmmakers and between NGOs, and what does ambitious storytelling look like day to day?
That's absolutely. Thank you for that question. That's also a central challenge that is faced when filmmakers and NGOs come together. Because there's having a filmmaker and an artist find a story within your work is different than hiring a shooter to tell the story that you want to tell. And it's hard for NGOs often to let go of the messaging and allow the filmmaker to find the story that they need to tell. And it's hard for the filmmaker to potentially shift their lens because of wanting to serve the NGO. And there's some folks working on some tutorials and online tools to help NGOs and artists work this out. It also can be very helpful to work through a funding organization and come together before you start on any project. Come together and lay out the expectations and ground rules. What lately I've been trying to suggest in a project that I've been trying to get off the ground is that if a filmmaker comes to work in country where you are and in partnership in some way, let that filmmaker go. Trust that filmmaker. Trust the voice. And if what comes back isn't exactly the message you might tell, I task the filmmakers with giving some of the footage that's not going in their film to the NGO and say, tell your story, or at least maybe doing a workshop with some of your staff and training you up to tell the story you need to tell. But it's, you know, even if your organization's message isn't exactly captured by the filmmaker, creatively there is so much potential to leverage that story on the ground and use it as a conversation starter. They don't need to mimic your exact talking points, but just acknowledging that the space is complicated and nuanced, and come to organizations like Sundance and BritDoc and others are very fluent in helping forge those partnerships between filmmakers and NGOs. There's a wonderful program called Good Pitch that if it comes to your town or city, it's all globally now, they select some of the top documentaries that are in production, and they invite NGO stakeholders and funders and broadcasters who might be able to leverage that film in community to come around the table and be part of an early advisory group, and also the first ones to be able to use that film. So I would recommend checking out goodpitch.org, and there's UK, US, China, India,
Australia,
that's right, everywhere. So it's that's a nice way in to start that conversation. You guys, we've got to stop. So do we have time for one more? Yeah. Vera? Okay. And then let's stay for a little bit and chat after.
I would like to share the experience that I live in Park City with Peter, Nixon, Nicole, Wendy, and it was a wonderful experience. I have the chance as a director of an NGO to really go deeply in the energy of a social entrepreneur and the filmmakers. That is such a funny and such a good time of my life, because I spend all my life fundraising, you know, international beggar and wanting for money to scale, money to do, money to realize our dream, our collective dream. And then when I was in the airplane going to Park City to participate in the storytelling workshop, I said, oh, how fun life can be, you know, being near filmmakers. I never thought about this. And then I have this incredible experience that being with Wendy and being with Peter and Nicole and all of them that are here. And I understood how powerful, instead of asking for money, I understood they help us to make a I Believe campaign, you know, the structure, a campaign that I want to make next year in Brazil to engage the civil society in Brazil. So, and through their films, I trust them because I saw a part of The Waiting Room, the film of Nicole and others, and I realized how powerful this campaign could be in Brazil, you know, putting millions of people in I Believe campaigns. So what I want really to share with you, that social entrepreneurs and filmmakers, we are so similar. Mm-hmm. And that opportunity that is emerging through to the Skoll Foundation, the Sundance, is a bless. Thank you.
That's a great way to end. Thank you all so much for coming. And please come find us and talk to us. We're around the rest of the week. You see who we are, and we just can't wait to hear more of your stories.